that brings people to their feet. Mighty men of world renown, I may never get to meet, but I have an invitation. Hasten to his throne and lay my petitions at his feet. Make my petition known.
I can pray. The storm around me rages. I can trust the rock of ages when I pray. And the peace I can explain when I call.
Father, your grace is greater than sin. Your mercy rains down and heals me nights. I cry for a way to your shining light. And Father, your grace is greater than sin. Your mercy rains down. It heals me again.
When you didn't know what to do and you call upon the Lord and he answers. Maybe it was that scripture you read this morning or yesterday evening, and he speaks to you through his word. I mean, He don't speak to us if we don't listen to what he has to say. I'm so thankful that I've been those tight places where I needed to hear from him. And he always come through. And it was, maybe it was a verse that I'd memorized years ago. Or maybe it's something that a Sunday school teacher might have said in the Sunday school class, or a message from the pulpit, but it was always his word. The answer came by his word. So thankful for it. Yeah. He's there when I call on him. Yeah. So thankful. Anyone have a testimony?
Jesus offered himself without spot
anything before the pastor comes. I mean, I was blessed this morning, his service. Then left here, supposed to have been over at South Charleston at the First Methodist Church for Kathy's 50th wedding anniversary. And they were five of her family, brothers and sisters there, that have 50 years or more years of marriage. Five of them all there today. That's a blessing in itself.
Turn your Bibles to 2 Timothy chapter 2. I didn't think he was ever going to ask me to preach. He finally did. God is good, amen? God has been good. I'll tell you what, I'd rather be a Christian as anything in the world. I'd rather be on my way to heaven, know for myself and not another that God is real in my life. And it's been 50 years. And it gets sweeter all the time. And I'm glad for the privilege to be saved. I'm glad that God loved me enough to save me. How he did and when he did. The difference he made in my life. And I'm on my way to heaven because of him and what he's done for me. And compared to what I've done to him, it's absolutely negative. It's nothing at all. Because he is the one that's doing it. And I love him. 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 1. I'd like to talk about we're at war. We're in a battle. God's got an army and he needs you. You're it. You're it. Paul's saying to Timothy, thou therefore, my son, be strong in the grace that is in Christ Jesus. And the things that thou hast heard of me among many witnesses, the same commit thou to faithful men. We need faithful people. Got to have faithful people so it can be committed. He won't commit it to the unfaithful. We've got to have it. Commit thou to faithful men who shall be able to teach others also. Faithful people teach others faithfulness and his goodness. Verse 3, thou therefore endure hardness as a good soldier of Jesus Christ. No man that warreth entangleth himself with the affairs of this life, that he may please him who hath chosen him to be a soldier. Father, we thank you for your goodness. We thank you, Lord, for these that are here tonight, and Lord, the privilege you have placed upon us years ago to preach, and now the honor tonight that I might stand in this place. Thank you for the privilege. Have your way. Use me, God, is my prayer. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you. I believe there's an urgency today to allow the Spirit to make the transition from a lamb to a lion, from sheep to a soldier. 2 Timothy 2:4, he says, no man that warreth entangleth himself with the affairs of this life, that he may please him. I hope you want to please him. Not just get through. Not just come to church. Not just be a part of this glorious group. But that our whole intention in life is to please him. And that's what the writer is saying him, that he may please him who hath chosen him to be a soldier. I want us to think about that for a little while. There are several different aspects of God's dealings when he deals with his church family. The most familiar is that of the family of God. This is the family of God. Most of us recognize and we count it an honor to be a part of the family of God. Amen? I mean, it's something that we can acquaint with and know and understand, and that is the most familiar way of looking at the congregation of people. But then he calls the church his building, his temple. He refers to us as a dwelling place for himself. He looks upon us and he says, there is where I live. That is where I dwell. This is where I meet them. They are the temple, the Holy Spirit. Who do we think we are anyway? Who do we think that the God of glory would choose us and say, I want to live in? Every now and then you ought to just shout a little bit and say, hey, God wants to live in me. God wants to be, he wants to be in my life. He wants to dwell in who I am. It ought to get us excited. I mean, every now and then, you don't have to go crazy. Every now and then, it ought to thrill your heart deep down in your soul that we're the temple of God. I don't know what that does for you. Calls them a church building, his temple. He says we're his husbandry, which means farmland. Y'all just farmland is all y'all. Then there's that relationship of the shepherd with the sheep. We like that, don't we? We like that. And Jesus is the sheep, a chief shepherd, and we're his sheep. We like that. We like Psalm 23, don't we? The Lord is my shepherd. We like that connection. We can understand that to some degree. And then he calls the church his workmanship created in Christ Jesus, found over there in Ephesians chapter 2 about verse 10. He says, now we are his workmanship. We don't like that as much. Not as the shepherd part. But when he gets to that workmanship part, you be workmanship, okay? I'll be sheep. We kind of draw back a little bit when it comes to that. But he says the church, the temple people, are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus. That means we are the works of his hands, like the potter's vessel in the hands of the potter creating something. We are his masterpiece. We are like the artist takes pleasure in what he creates, and we're created by the hands of God. God It's not over when we get up off of the blue pad and we walk down the aisle and we go home and we get. It's not over then. That is the birthing place. That is where it begins. That is when God begins to mold and to make and create in us something for His glory, something for His business, something for His work. All of these are different aspects of our relationship to Christ, to God, our Lord. And He wants to work in our lives. He wants to work in us. So when I speak of you, I can address you as God's flock, and you'll understand. I can say you're His sheep, and you will agree with me, or His building, or His temple, or His dwelling place, or His handiwork, or His masterpiece. Had you ever picture yourself as a masterpiece? Raise your hand. Down. You know what that is? That means where He can display you in a prominent place for others to acknowledge what God has done in you. Amen. Something to show off in a world that needs somebody to tell them that God is real, and He points you out to them. He says, hey, have you considered my servant Job? You know, when they all gathered around out there, has God ever in His wildest understanding of you said, have you considered my servant, and then insert your name in there? I mean, has it ever become something that you could at least think of in your mind that God has worked on you to the point He could say, here He is. Here she is. What an aspiration. I believe it ought to start. Hey, I don't know about you. I don't know about you. But there was a long time ago, I said, God, if you can do something in my life, I want to be that. Have you ever said that? Have you ever said, God, do something with my life? Create something that others can acknowledge that your handprints are upon me. Expose me to the country that is around. Let them know. Let my family know. Let my children know. Let my parents know. Let my neighbors know. Let those know around me that I'm yours. And let it be evident. My, what an aspiration we need to have that. I might address you as the husbandry. This farmland where He sows His good seed and He produces His good fruit. Are you fertile in that understanding? We are where He grows His crop. We are those that God has plowed, has crossed asunder, has cast out the stones and pushed aside the rubbish of this world and allowed something beautiful to spring up out of our dirtiness, that He would get the glory and the honor and the praise. Who are we that the Son of God would do that? For us to display us in His marketplace, that others may see our good works and not come up to you and say, boy, what a nice fellow you are. We are not the end result of what God is doing. God is doing. God's the one that deserves the praise when Cindy don't have a problem. God is the one that deserves the praise when He reaches down and He saves someone right in that location. It is God that deserves the grace and the praise unto His name for what He has done in our life. So if I ask you if your husbandry, if you're just a piece of farmland that God uses, take an inventory of what fruit produces.
production is coming forth out of your life. Preacher got quiet. I might even call you his vineyard, as Jesus mentioned in John chapter 15. He said, I am the vine and you are the branches. And so he looked at us as a bunch of sticks and he said, I can make some life come out of you. If you dwell in me, my words dwell in you. All of these wonderful aspects or facets of our relationship with the Lord, they are one aspect of our relationship, but I want to get to my point tonight. That's the army of God. Good soldier. The Bible calls God a man of war in Exodus 15. He's a man of war. The Bible calls Jesus the captain of our salvation in Hebrews chapter 2. In the Bible, Israel was God's army. But today, the church is God's army. We're it as far as your family is concerned. We're it to fight off every ward of the devil in this community. You and I are it. We're the ones that need the call to muster. We're the ones that need to stand at attention into the face of the commander in chief and say, God, I'm reporting for duty, sir. We're the army. We're the ones that's going to make a difference if there's going to be a difference made. We're the army. In the Bible, Israel was God's army. Today we're it. We must understand that we may be sheep, but these sheep were also soldiers. I'm talking about the spiritual bunch. You and I, the sheep of his pasture. That's what he was talking about in 2 Timothy chapter 2. He said, I've called you sheep to be saved. I want you to rise up and do that. Remember, the captain of this army, the Lamb of God. But if you read over in the book of Revelation, he is also the Lion of the tribe of Judah. He goes from the Lamb to the Lion. So a different object, different picture, a different place in our life. There's a time when we're like sheep. We're quiet and obedient and friendly and faithful, and we follow the shepherd, but when the war comes, the sheep must transform into soldiers. There's got to be a transformation that takes place. Are you listening to me? Am I preaching to you? There's got to be a time in our life that we go from the lush valleys in the place where the shepherd watches, until we gird up our loin and go into the valley of Elah and destroy something. We're the ones. It's fallen to us. Our church is not just gathering place for sheep to gather. We must be good soldiers, according to Paul's writing. Not just a loving family, but also a bold, fully equipped, well-trained army that is a threat to hell. That's a danger to the damned world. We've got to be a threat to that. We've got to, having done all to stand therefore, having our loins girt about with truth, taking the shield of faith. Oh, and that equipment dispatched to God's faithful people. We've got to assume the position. We've got to allow God to come into our life, and so that we might become a formidable opponent. I heard Leonard Ravenhill in 1973 in Nashville, Tennessee. He said, by God's grace, I'll be one of the 10 most wanted in hell. Have you ever challenged the devil at all? the Lord is our shepherd, and he prepares a table before me in the presence of mine enemies, and I don't have to do anything except just sit down and acknowledge the shepherd that is always there, that's always protecting me. Have you ever stepped in the devil's face and say, not in my life? He said, I've chosen some that are faithful to be soldiers. And it's time I took it no more. Not just about tending sheep, about training soldiers. David is a perfect example of a sheep soldier. He's a young shepherd. He's a young shepherd. He tended the sheep. He smelled like the sheep. He thought like the sheep. He loved the sheep. He was a tender and carrier and a caregiving. And David was a worshiper. He was someone that worshiped, sitting in the night with his sheep, and this young shepherd would no doubt out there in the peaceful meadows of the Palestinian gatherings in that face of the world, as he looked up into the stars and beheld the beauty, I believe he sat there on the mountainside and worshiped the God of those stars. Have you ever done that? Have you ever been out there when the stars shoot across the sky? And the glory of God is seen and surrounded. It makes you want to sit there and worship. And David was that in the night watches when the midnight came. And yet he worshiped the Lord, the God of glory, the power of the eternal coming down from him out of heaven. And he worshiped the creator of all the universe. He was a worshiper. Sitting in that night with his sheep, his young shepherd was a worshiper, and he was also a warrior. One day he's holding a wounded little lamb in his arm. The next day he's holding a giant's head in his hand, cut off with his own sword. You see the difference. That difference ought to appear in your life. There ought to be some ability for you to stand as a formidable force against the wiles of the devil, taking the shield that will protect you in every way, that we might be what God wants us to be. Hey, preacher, why is it so important? Why do we need to understand this? Because we're at war in our community. We're at war in our family. We're at war in our country. We're at war within our own understanding. The devil is advancing. I'm talking about a spiritual war that is taking place in our home and in the lives of those we love and care about. The devil has stirred up demons. Demons are stepping up their activities. Things are happening on a grand scale. The devil's winning more battles than you. The devil is winning more battles than your family. The devil is winning the battles in our nation. He's winning those battles. Every now and then I'll read or I'll hear somebody say, preacher, I would rather ask for forgiveness, or I'd rather apologize than to go by the rules and do it right or ask permission. You ever heard that? And what we're saying is, I'm going to do something wrong. And then it happens in it, and then while we're apologizing, while we're saying I'm sorry, people are plunging into hell and going to a devil's keeping place. While we're apologizing that we're not the children of God we ought to be, that we're not as close as we should be, while we make up excuse after excuse and reason after reason, while we are what we are, The fact of the matter is, we're not the soldier God wants us to be. And so we make an apology. But while we apologize, Pastor, people are perishing. Without any hope. People look at sheep and think them weak and timid and defenseless and without power. But that's our relationship to the shepherd. There's another side. There's another side to the sheep. You ought to just kind of look over there at your neighbor and tell them there's more to me than you see. There's more to me than you see. When I was a kid, I was a kid a long time ago, there was a show on TV. It was called The Incredible Hulk. Huh? Am I preaching yet? The Incredible Hulk. Bill Bigsby, just a normal, everyday guy. And he gets a dose of gamma rays. An overdose of gamma rays. And a change takes over. A transformation. Something then, after he gets his overdose, something happens. And he's like, somebody makes him angry. Something does something to him and he gets angry. And a metamorphosis. A change. A transformation occurs. He tells people around him, don't make me angry. You won't like me. Y'all remember, said, some of y'all, I know it's over your head, but some of y'all, don't make me angry. You won't like me when I'm angry. Because when he gets angry, he transforms into this big green-skinned monster. With incredible power and strength. And he then becomes unstoppable. He is something to be dealt with. When something gets him angry, somebody needs to tell the devil today, you better back off, sucker, because I'm angry. Some of y'all ain't made the devil mad in a long time. What you need are a few gamma rays of God's Holy Spirit. You need a little anger building up in your life. Talking about holy anger, I'm talking about a righteous indignation. That's what I'm talking about. I'm talking about the kind of anger that rises up in you when you see people being overwhelmed by Satan. You don't have to look for it. Children being raped. When you see drugs and alcohol abuse in our families. When you see little children forced to learn things that will twist, pervert their minds at a young age so that they might accept that as normal, try to make us angry. Let me tell you something, church. It's not wrong to get angry. Anger's a powerful force. When it's channeled in the right direction. I'm not talking about when you get cut off in traffic. Not angry when someone doesn't shake your hand or pay attention to you. That's the devil. Doesn't have anything to do with God. That's wrong. when you get angry over stuff that's not godly, it's wrong. Not an anger because you don't angry because you preaching to you. Am I telling you that we've got to be careful what we get angry about? But we need to get angry about something. We need to be troubled about some things. Needs to be something. No telling. You know, it was an angry mother who lost a child to a drunk driver that started the mass. The mother's against drunk drivers. And it's hard to say how many countless of thousands have been saved because she channeled her anger in the right direction, doing the right thing. Yes, I'm a sheep, but I'm also a soldier. Yes, I'm a worshiper, but I'm also a warrior. Makes me angry when mothers and fathers miss church. Have you ever known me to tell you I believe you ought to go all the time? Haven't been able to tell you that. It makes me angry when they don't. It's not a passive thing with me, because I've lived long enough to see the importance of sitting on those blue pews every time the doors are open. It makes me angry when schoolwork and activities are more important than going to the house of God. It makes me angry. And I don't need to have any kids anymore. Got some grandkids that are going to school, but if my children ever call me up and say, "Daddy, we missed church today because of an activity at school," I'm going to blow my top. Makes me angry when the most important thing in this world is not God. You say, "Preacher, kids must have an education. The most important thing in this world is missing hell. That's the only reason we're here. We're not here to get a college education. We're here to miss hell. We're not here to build a fine house and drive a Ford truck. We're here so that when our time comes, we're saved on our way to heaven. Somewhere down the road, through the channels of time, over the past of that, something has got messed up in our mind when we say something is more important than going to church, being what God wants us to be. If you put God first, all things will take care of themselves. If you put God second in your life, you will die lost and burn forever in a lake of fire that goes forever. If you put God second, seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you." We either believe that or we don't. Makes me angry when we preach funerals and there's no real proof that the man is on his way to heaven. It breaks my heart, and it makes me angry inside when somebody is rolled into a coffin placed before people. Everybody wants him to go to heaven. Everybody wants him to be saved, but there's no proof. There's no clarity. There's no matter of fact. That's where it's at. It angers me. It builds up in me every time I've got to make that call and go and sit with a family and weep and weep and knowing there's no clarity. fulfill, the greatest thing in this world is to work and to have a job. I'm sorry. I retract that. I'm not sorry. Make it. You can gain the whole world. That's the conclusion of the matter. That's the end result. David understood this sheep, soldier, warrior, worshiper mentality. He understood that. In Psalm 23, he said, "The Lord is my shepherd, shall not want." He also recognized that he was a soldier. In Psalm 144, verse 1, he said, "Blessed be the Lord God, my strength, which teacheth my hands to war. And my fingers." He's taught us to worship. He's taught us to raise our hands in praise to Him. But the psalmist said, "He's taught my fingers for war. He's taught my hands for battle. He's instilled in me the tenacity to shake my head at the devil's pranks and all that he has and stand strong in his might." David said, "He's taught me to do that. Taught me how to fight." In the book of Jeremiah, God is talking about his sheep soldiers. Listen to how God refers to you and I. In 51, Jeremiah 51. "Trust me," says, "thou art my battle axe, weapons of war, for with thee will I break in pieces the nation. And with thee I will destroy kingdoms, and with thee will I break in pieces the horses and rider, and with thee," he's talking about us. How about, what are you going to do all this tearing up with? Enemy. He said, "And with thee will I break in pieces the chariot and his rider." He said, "With you," preacher preached on old Gideon over there. You know what I like about that story he preached on last morning? I love that it's a good message. You know what I like about it? He comes up to old Gideon there, and as he's threshing out corn, he's hiding over here out of the bushes because he doesn't want anybody to see because he's sick. And you know what he calls him? He says, "Oh, mighty man of valor." He said, "You brave thing, you mighty warrior, you great and glorious thing," because he had a job. We're timid, we're weak, we're insecure to do battle. And God wants us, God needs us. God says to the church, "You sheep soldiers," he said, you're not only warriors, but you're worshipers, and you're warriors because you're worshipers. You want to be able to raise your hand Sunday morning and give praise on Sunday night? Go out and fight a battle and win. Did you ever see an army coming back with victory in the background? They've got stuff hanging all over them because of the battle, and they're jumping about this high. I went hunting with a fella not too long ago, and we was out in the woods, and darkness come, and he shot a big buck. Well, it wasn't all that big anyway. It was just a 6 or 8 point, something like that. But he was a jumping this high. Woo! He was saying, "Woo! Hey, did you? Hey, run!" And I hadn't even quit hunting yet. He come right up to me. He was excited, hollering and squalling right through the quietness of my little place. He was a holler and carrying on. Why? Because he is dead. Let me ask you a question tonight in all sincerity. When was the last time you down? I know the devil fights us on every hand. When's the last time y'all got it? When's the last time? You know what I like about David? I told you before, I'm going to tell you, it's hard to tell when I get preaching. You know what I like about David? Is when he came to the father's table the next morning after having held that lamb, jerked it out of that lion's mouth. And he said, Daddy, the lion came in last night, but he didn't get me. You know, I like that. Every now and then, when we're having breakfast with the Lord, we said, Lord, the devil came last night, but he didn't get me. He showed up on my doorstep, that he came to where I was, but he didn't get me. In reason, sometimes we ain't got to shout because he's gone. He just gone. We're overwhelmed. We don't have any shout. Don't have any victory in our life. We didn't get it. The devil is winning most battles today. Say what you want to, be as spiritual as you want to be. But the devil is winning more battles than you are, and we've got to do something about it. We've got to do something about that. Sheep are gentle and kind, and they're obedient and all of that. David relates to hell and the devil's work. We must be as ruthless and as bold as David. He went from nursing a lamb caught in a lion's mouth, holding the head of that giant that had been cursing God. That's what he went for. Sitting on the placid hill as a worshiper, giving praise to the Lord. Oh, he stuck his hand in there a time or two, smacked the lion on the jaw. But on the next few pages, he's standing there before Israel with the giant's head cut off by his own sword and say, this man was cursing God. There ought to be some of devil's blood on your hands. You ought to be making some invention someplace. The devil, from time to time, ought to be angry with you and saying to himself, what in the world am I going to do with him? And we probably don't come up with, on his conversation. Say, preacher, what are we going to do? I better quit. Preacher, he's never going to let me preach this. We've got to start eating our spiritual spinach. The Word of God. We need an overdose of Holy Ghost radiation, gamma rays. We need to put on the full armor of God. We need that. We need to transform. We need a metamorphosis into the Holy Ghost-filled, baptized sons and daughters of the living God. We need some power that we've not drained or tapped into lately. We need that in our life so that we might be more than conquerors through Him that loved us. Do you think David went out there one day placidly on a hillside and went from that to the valley of Elah and dragging the giant's head out? Do you think he went through that on his own? No, he was a ruddy little shepherd boy. He was a shepherd boy that went from being a shepherd to a soldier. What's upon his life? What's the need, preacher? The need is for you to take on the whole armor of God. And let God transform you into what He wants you to be. Yes, the Lord is our shepherd. We enjoy the benefits of His pasture, and we ought to have that. But when it comes to the battle game, we got to push away from His table and say, God, let me. When it comes to hell, when it comes to the plans of Satan, His plots, His schemes, and we know that our family getting the worst of it. We need to show up. And we need to be faithful unto Him. We can't remain living in lush pastures. The worshipers must become a warrior. The sheep must become soldiers to the cause of Christ and be fully equipped. If we're not careful, devil will continue to rob and root out and to destroy and take down stragglers in our life. When we just let it go, when it's no big thing, when we'll catch you next week, preacher, I'll read my Bible after a while, I'll pray after a while, you become a straggler and the devil's got you. I watched that hyena show this morning on the channel. I don't know if you saw it or not. You know what that hyena does? One of them gazelles out there all by itself. It's playing in it. Hopping in it, kicking. That hyena went out there, drug it down by the throat, and brought it to its den and sucked every bit of the life out. Every bit. Showed it right there on the television. But there's a big deal, I'm saying. If you're struggling, the devil is going to get you. It breaks my heart. It makes me angry. When God's not first in people's lives. I'm through preaching. Let's stand. Somebody may need to pray. Trust that God would speak to your heart. Trust that He'll do something in your life. And if you need to pray, you know of people you need to be praying for. Situations that you need to be talking to God about. You're not fit for war. You ought to come and say, God, help me. I can be what I need to be. You need to pray tonight for whatever the purpose might be. I beg you to come tonight and say, God, have your way in me. Make me, mold me, create in me that which I need to be. Because there's so much church, there's so much. You're His army. You're the power stroke of His sword. You're the victory for His mastery. You're His power. He's given it to us. Please pray. Brother Lindell, sing. By the way, Lindell's my hero. You need to pray. The altar's open. Let God have His way.
When my way groweth drear, precious Lord, linger near. When my life,
let the Lord have His way in your life,
is almost gone.
God cares about you.
Hear my cry.
You need to pray.
Hear
we got
my
time
call
tonight for you to pray.
Hold my hand.
You need to pray. You come.
I fall. Take my
There's a reason hand tonight for you to pray.
Precious Lord,
I beg that you'd come.
Lead me home. Precious Lord, take my hand. Lead me on. Let me stand. I am tired. I am weak. I am worn. Through the storm, through the night, lead me on to the light. Take my hand, precious Lord. Lead me home. When the shadows appear and the night draweth near, when the days
and gone. At the river I'll stand, guide my feet, hold my hand, take my hand. Precious Lord, lead me home. Precious Lord, take my hand, lead me on, let me stand. I am tired, I am weak, I am worn. Through the storm, through the night, lead me on to the light. Take my hand, precious Lord, lead me home.